Good morning and welcome to 5 Before the Bell, TheStreet.com's daily market preview and European market update right here from the central London studios of Core TV. I'm Martin Baccardax. I am the London Bureau Chief at TheStreet.com. I'm going to take you through those five things you need to know before the bell. It's a quiet August day in Europe, but there's lots to talk about nonetheless, and we're going to get right to it and look at what's happening on European bourses. We have a decent amount of closures today, it must be said. Owing to the August holiday period, we have markets that are down and dark today in Italy and in Belgium and in elsewhere. But what we have open are the main ones in France, Germany, the United Kingdom, and Switzerland, and they're all doing relatively well. Now, we had a decent session in Asia, not a blowout, but a decent return to risk as a result of that very strong session last night on Wall Street, which saw the S&P 500 rise the most since April. So effectively, cooling tensions in and around North Korea, the result of some statements from the North Korean military officials that basically said they were going to monitor events in and around the region, and they weren't planning an imminent missile strike near or at the U.S. territory of Guam, has sort of given a bit of a sigh of relief and led to the rally that we've seen overnight and indeed in the United States yesterday. Now, what's interesting about the European rally is it is muted a little bit, given the fact that we had slightly softer than expected GDP data out of Germany today. The economy, the biggest in Europe, grew at a 0.6% clip. That was a little bit less than we were looking for, but still very solid nonetheless. And again, I think the fact that we have some of the thin volumes owing to the holiday closures is putting a bit of a cap on gains. But it's still relatively healthy, and we're still looking at decent, if not certainly not spectacular, but very decent gains for Wall Street at the moment. Now, it is probably worth mentioning, too, that we had softer than expected UK inflation data for the month of July. It came in at 2.6. Economists were looking at somewhere in the region of 2.7, and that trimmed gains for sterling against the US dollar. In fact, it traded at a one-month low at one stage. But it has eliminated all talk of imminent rate hikes from the Bank of England, and that is going to have downward implications for sterling, and certainly the news that we're seeing with respect to Britain's negotiations with the European Union and the broader Brexit discussions are not moving in the government's direction, and that doesn't tend to be supportive for the pound either. Okay, we're going to move on to one of the more fascinating shares today in the European space, and that's Danone, the French dairy group. Yogurt is about 50% of its annual revenues, and it's one of the biggest makers in the world. You'll recognize it in the United States as the Danone brand, and it, of course, it is one of the most well-recognized in the world. Now, there is speculation, started yesterday with a New York Post story that it could be a takeover target, and it accelerated today with news from Bloomberg that said Corvex management had built a stake worth around 400 million euros in the group. It would put it just outside the top 10 holders and would be less than 1%, but nonetheless, it's an activist stake, and it's one that does tend to be vocal, and it does tend to get the attention of management. Now, I think we can talk about the takeover speculation and dismiss that almost immediately. This is a company that has been described on various occasions by the French government as the jewel of an industry that is very important to it. The dairy industry is worth about 37 to 40 billion euros in revenues each and every year, and it employs more than 250,000 people directly and many tens of thousands more indirectly as a result. These are the kind of jobs that simply would not be put at risk by the French government, and they would step in and protect it if necessary. Now, some people have said, however, that the fact that we have a new president in France, Emmanuel Macron, who shares many of the same business characteristics as his opposite number in the United States, President Donald Trump, well, that could wake up officials to the idea that they didn't need to stand in front of a foreign takeover. But Monsieur Macron's popularity in France isn't as high as it was when he was elected, and his mandate isn't as strong as his predecessor. So I think the idea that the government wouldn't get involved is probably far-fetched, and that might be what's limiting gains. The shares are up 2%, and they're up about 3.5% over the past 2 days. The activist stake, however, is an important one, and Corvex is certainly more and more active in the European space. It, of course, is getting involved in the Clariant-Huntsman merger. It doesn't like that. It's trying to slow it down or stop it altogether. We don't know exactly what ambitions it has with respect to Danone, but it's a share that trades rather cheaply to Unilever and Nestle, its peer group, and it's one that has certainly margin improvement potential. And this is exactly where a lot of the activists go when they look at companies in the consumer food space, and Danone is going to be no exception. So we're going to watch that one with interest. We may not know how it shakes out for a few weeks, but it's a powerful stock. It's one that's been underperforming so far this year, and as a result of this recent speculation, it's woken up. It's it's one that's worth taking a look at because it certainly does have very, very high potential going forward. Certainly not as a takeover takeout, but definitely one related to what we are seeing in the activist space. And of course, this just speaks to the broader activist sphere that we have been witnessing in European stocks over the past 4 to 5 months. And that isn't going away anytime soon either. All right, moving on to the United States and the President's Manufacturing Council, which has lost 3 members in the past 24 hours as a result of the President's slow-footed response to the ugly events that were witnessed in Charlottesville, Virginia over the weekend. Ken Frazier, of course, from Merck, was the first to leave the council as a result of the President's response, lack of response, many people said. Brian Krzynich from Intel followed shortly after, and Kevin Plank from Under Armour, who was a former and vocal supporter of the President, has also decided to leave the council. Now, unfortunately, and for reasons that only the President will be able to explain, Ken Frazier is the only gentleman of the three that has been the subject of invective on Twitter. He has fired off a couple of angry rounds on social media over the past couple of days against Merck, against pricing practices in the drugs industry, and against Mr. Frazier's decision to leave the council. But I do think this is interesting because it speaks to a couple of problems that the President is going to face as a result of his slow-footed response. He, of course, refused to specifically name white supremacists as part of the reason that there were violence over the weekend and only did so on Monday, many people say, as a result of public pressure. What we're seeing in the corporate space, though, is now an accelerating campaign on social media for the CEOs that remain on the council and why they are deciding to put their support behind the President after these weekend's events, which were just completely unsettling. And of course, as we know, ended in the death of one protester after a car was rammed into a group of counter-demonstrators in the center of Charlottesville. It also has to be remembered that the President is spending more and more of his political capital each and every day in order to maintain headline control as a result of the myriad implications that he has been involved in with respect to scandals in Russia, trade in China, and you name it. This is just the latest of the domestic policy machinations that are complicating the President's administration and his life indeed over the past 4 or 5 months. The more capital he spends to keep his allies on board, the less he has to put forward to tax and health care reform. Now, a survey from Bloomberg today did indicate that a vast majority of economists do believe he is going to get his tax reform probably by November 2018. But it doesn't appear that it's going to come anytime soon, and it certainly doesn't appear that it's going to come between now and the end of the year, unless there's a very quick and very dynamic sea change in the political landscape in the United States. That is going to have definitive and arithmetic implications for the U.S. stock market because a good portion of the recent gains have been linked to the assumption that corporate tax is going to be hived quite significantly. When and how it's going to manifest itself is hard to be known, but it cannot be disconnected at this point. And I do think the fact that you have high-profile CEOs of some of the biggest companies in the United States pulling away the support from the President as a result of his reaction is only going to mean that there will be more and more scrutiny over the President's statements in the coming weeks and months. And that, of course, is going to have, again, if not direct, certainly tangential implications for U.S. stocks and the stocks of the companies that are still associated with the President's Council. Moving on to one of the most famous investors in the United States, Warren Buffett. Q2 filings with the Securities and Exchange Commission last night show some of the changes in his Berkshire Hathaway portfolio, and they are interesting indeed. Synchrony Financial, which is an issuer of credit cards on a white label basis and on a retail basis, is the biggest beneficiary. He's built a stake worth about $520 million in the group, which, interestingly, was spun off by GE. Now, I say interestingly because Mr. Buffett has trimmed all of his GE holdings, according to that Q2 filing. It's something that he had started back in 2012, but he got rid of the last bit in the 3 months ending in June. At the same time, he has built up the stake in Synchrony, which I think is interesting as well. Now, it's an interesting play on many levels. Firstly and foremostly, on the consumer credit market in the United States, which many people are growing increasingly concerned about with respect to the record high debt levels that many Americans are holding on exactly the kind of cards that are issued by Synchrony Financial. This doesn't seem to be troubling Mr. Buffett. Otherwise, he is not the kind of gentleman that would take this sort of risk. We know that he's built his stake in American Express over a number of years and continues to do so, and this is a business that he does have confidence in. I think from Synchrony's point of view, you could argue the fact that they do seem to be focusing more on customers with higher FICO scores than those with lower ones, and they took a decent amount of write-downs already this year, may suggest that they are changing tact a little bit with respect to whom they lend to. But I also think their association with Amazon is very, very important as well in the value play that this stock provides. And of course, we know there is no more famous value investor than Mr. Buffett himself. Interesting on the outside of that is the fact that Mr. Buffett has trimmed some of its holdings in the airlines groups, which he has famously increased earlier this year, American Airlines and Delta being amongst them. And again, worth noting that he has now severed all of his ties with GE, the former parent, as you will remember, the former parent of Synchrony Financial, nonetheless. And I do think that's an interesting play indeed. Okay, we want to take a look at Wall Street right now, called 56 higher on the Dow Jones Industrial Average as we speak. The S&P 500 looks like it's going to add about 5.75 points to yesterday's gains, which, as mentioned, were the biggest since April for the benchmark of U.S. stocks. And the NASDAQ, which of course is more tech-focused, is set to rise about 0.3%. Now, one number that I want to bring up at the moment, however, is Home Depot. I haven't been able to get an exact figure as to where the shares may trade at the start of the session today, but they had much better than anticipated second quarter results and actually lifted their guidance for the full year. The stock is only called up about 0.8% at the moment, but I do think that is going to change given the blowout figures that we saw. And again, Home Depot just seems to be one of those companies that is able to defy some of the gloom that we are seeing in the United States retail sector, and I do think that this might be an interesting one to take a look at. I do apologize, I'm not able to pull up the formal figures at the moment. Q2 earnings came in at $2.25 per share. Actually, I can show you the brief right now. $2.25 per share was the Q2 earnings and sales of $28.1 billion. Those did beat estimates as we had them on thestreet.com, and they see full-year sales rising about 5.3%, so that's improved full-year guidance. So again, 0.8% to the upside is where Home Depot is called, but I suspect that is going to rise higher, although investors might be looking, of course, for the broader U.S. retail sales figures, which are coming in a few minutes' time. Okay, that's it for us for Five Before the Bell, and that is it for me, in fact, as I head off on a well-earned holiday. At least, I hope it's well-earned. I'm going to have to ask my boss about that, but I think he agrees because he did sign the papers, and it's too late for me to change the tickets now. So I'll see you guys back on the 29th of August, but I want to say thank you, very graciously and very genuinely for all the support that you've been showing for Five Before the Bell, this new project, which is going to ramp up significantly into the fall right here at Core TV. It's an interesting partnership. It's one that we're very proud of, and one that we do intend to grow in the weeks and months ahead. So I'm going to join you at the end of the summertime, and we're going to head into September together. And again, I thank you for your support, and we're going to keep it rolling here on Five Before the Bell. Have a great 10 days, and we'll see you in a couple of weeks.